بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. وبعد, we begin then in today's session with the study of the seerah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we say, إخوان, by the bid, that the study of the seerah, particularly for the one who is trying to look at the topic from a point of view of authenticity and of siha, there is something of a struggle, ayyuhal ikhwa, that one has to have a study of the seerah that is not disjointed and maintain authenticity. Since what is well known, ikhwan, with the scholars of hadith and with the mu'arrikhun, scholars of history, is that the principles of hadith, the stringent principles of hadith that were employed by the muhaddithun with the study of the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, weren't utilized with the same level of stringency with the maghazi and with siyab. And so the books that deal with and discuss the history of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the wars, that which is related to the seerah, did not have the same level of stringency in terms of authenticity that the scholars of the sunnah had. Na'am, they would collect the narrations with asanid and with chains of narration, but in terms of the stringency of the people of hadith and of the scholars of hadith with the sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, ikhwan, then their approach was not the same. And so there has been of recent times an attempt to purify the seerah from that which has been added to the seerah from narrations that are not authentic, many of them, ikhwan, being popular narrations that many of you may be familiar with from your childhood hearing concerning the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so what we want to look at then, inshallah, throughout this series is, number one, we are going to our level best, stick and cling to authenticity as much as possible. Wherever there is a narration, ikhwan, that there is some skepticism concerning whether or not it is established, and we'll mention that here some of the scholars say, or we'll make mention of the fact that in regards to this issue, it is mentioned in some of the classical books of seerah, but mathalan, there isn't a chain of narration that establishes it or what have you. We likewise point out the ahadith that are da'ifa and weak and not established from the ahadith and the narrations, ikhwan, that are, or even the narrations related to prior to the coming of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that may be popular in some of the books of seerah, and study them and have a look at them, ikhwan, and mention the statements of the scholars of hadith concerning them and their weakness. And so, of course, ikhwan, when we're looking at the study of the seerah, we're looking at the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib. And there is no doubt, ikhwan, that the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his lineage was Arabi asil, that he was from the purest of the Arab. And of course, ikhwan, the tribes of the Arab, when we're speaking about the Arab, we're speaking about those who dwell and exist within the Arabian Peninsula, and those who carry out or fulfill certain conditions. As far as the Arabian Peninsula is concerned, then if we were, ikhwan, one of the ways that we want to envision the Arabian Peninsula, and the reason that we want to envision the Arabian Peninsula is because of the fact that it is the subject, of course, of the seerah, and many of the aspects and issues related to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and likewise that which is related to the presence of some of the tribes and the movement of some of the peoples around the Shibh Qara al-Arabiya or Shibh Jazeera. The Arabian Peninsula, ikhwan, or the Shibh Jazeera al-Arabiya, when the scholars mention the Shibh or refer to it as Shibh Jazeera, Shibh meaning pseudo, or if you like, semi, or not completely. And so when they say that it was not completely, or a reference, if we were to literally translate it, it would be a translation of the fact that the Arabian Peninsula was not a complete island. And so they refer to it as Shibh Jazeera, as
that which is almost an island or pseudo island. And the reason that they would refer to it as Shibha Jazeera, because if you look at the Arabian Peninsula, if you were to envision it as a rectangle that's on its side, you know, a rectangle that is on its side, although it tilts slightly in one direction, but if you were to envision it as a rectangle, the bottom and the two sides are surrounded by sea. And so in that sense, it is almost an island. But from the tops of the Jazeera, the two ends of the Jazeera, they are connected to the rest of Asia in that region. And so if you were to look at it, Ikhwan, if you were to envision that rectangle then in your head, yani that we're looking at it long lengthwise, and it is standing on its side. If you were to start from the left-hand side, the top left-hand corner of the rectangle, and we were to work around the rectangle to the opposite side, from the top left-hand corner, Ikhwan, we have Sham. That is up in the top left-hand corner. And try and envision it in your head, because envisioning it, when we envision it, and we make mention of the movement of some of the peoples and so on, we want to try and return back to that vision of the rectangle that we have in our heads. So if we look from the top left-hand corner, we have Sham. And then if we come down about a third of the way down, we have Medina. If we come about halfway down, we have Mecca. This is again along the left-hand side of that rectangle. If we continue another quarter of the way down, yani further down, we have a region known as Najran. If we continue down to the right angle on the left-hand side, we have the country of Yemen. Starting at the top of that right angle with Sana'a, and if we go down to the bottom corner and then continue across the bottom, approximately halfway across the rectangle, we have Hadramaut. If we continue to the opposite side of the bottom of that rectangle, this bottom corner, the right-hand corner, is Bahrain. The other one is Umman. And if you continue up along the right-hand side, the length of that rectangle, we have Bahrain. In the middle, from the halfway mark, in the middle of the rectangle, we have Najd. And the bottom of the rectangle, we have the Ruba' al-Khali, that is the empty quarter. And that is desolate. No one lives within it. It is pure desert. And so again, if you envision that rectangle, from the top left, Sham, the region of Sham, which includes Syria, Jordan, Israel, and those regions, or Syria, Jordan, Jerusalem, and those regions. We come down along the left-hand side, about a third of the way down, we come to Medina. We continue to about halfway down, we come to Mecca. We continue another, perhaps quarter way down, Najran, Mumtaz. We continue down, we have Yemen. The whole of that corner, the bottom corner, is Yemen. Starting with Sana'a, and then in the middle of the rectangle itself, we have Hadramaut. Then we continue to the opposite side of the rectangle. We have Umman, Mumtaz, and we carry on along the rectangle upwards. We have Bahrain. Then at the top of the right-hand side of that rectangle, where it rejoins the rest of Asia, we have Iraq, Mumtaz. We have Iraq. As far as the Arabian Peninsula and the seas that surround it, on the left-hand side, we have the Red Sea. Along the bottom, we have the Arabian Sea, which is likewise referred to as the Indian Sea. And then along the right-hand side, we have the Gulf, or the Arabian Gulf, or the Omani Gulf. And it's referred to as a Gulf because it is a lot slimmer than the other regions. The piece of land on the opposite side of the right-hand side is Persia, and the piece of land on the left-hand side is Masr, Mumtaz, is Egypt. And so if we're able to envision it, ikhwan, it will help as we work through the seerah, inshallah. So we have that rectangle. Generally, when you look at a map, it is tilted to the side, slightly leans towards the left. But from the left, we have Syria. Coming down, we have Medina. Coming down, we have Mecca. Coming down, we have Sana'a, the whole of that corner, Najran, Mumtaz, Sana'a, the whole of that corner being Yemen. Then in the middle of the bottom of the rectangle, we have Hadramaut. Then over on the right-hand side, we have Umman. Carrying on up, we have Bahrain. And at the top, we have Iraq. Ahsan. Allah yajzak khair. And so that then is the Arabian Peninsula. And that is, of course, ikhwan, what the bulk of our studies is going to, or for the most part, all of our studies, as far as the seerah is concerned, is going to revolve around. Similarly, ikhwan, as it relates to the Arabian Peninsula, it would not be referred to as the Arabian Peninsula if it didn't contain Arab. Now, and so the Arab then, they are a particular people. And Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, he defines who we mean by the Arab. He mentions, rahimahullah ta'ala, وَإِسْمُ الْعَرَبِ وَاسْمُ الْعَرَبِ فِي الْأَصْلِ كَانَ إِسْمًا لِقَوْمٍ جَمَعُوا ثَلَاثَةَ أَوْصَافٍ. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, he mentions that the name or the term Arab, in its origin, is a term that refers to a people who gather three characteristics. People who gather three characteristics. أَحَدُهَا أَنَّ لِسَانَهُمْ كَانَ بِاللُّغَ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ. The first of them is that their tongue is with اللغة العربية. Their tongue is Arabic. The second, أَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا مِنْ أَوْلَادِ الْعَرَبِ. The second of them is that they are from the offsprings of Arab. That is, that their parents, their forefathers, they were Arab. And that is that their lineage is Arabi. And when we're speaking of the Arabic, we'll discuss what is intended by being from the awlad or from the children of the Arab. The third of those conditions he mentioned was thalith, anna masakinahum kanat ardul Arab. Wa hiya jaziratul Arab allati hiya min bahr al-Qulzum ila bahr al-Basra. ومن أقصى هجر باليمن إلى أوائل الشام بحيث كانت تدخل اليمن في دارهم ولا تدخل الشام. And so the third then is that they used to dwell, or their dwelling places are in the Arabian Peninsula. And then he describes the Arabian Peninsula as we have described it, يعني the piece of land that is surrounded by those seas, by the Arabian Sea, by the Red Sea, and by the Arabian Gulf. That then, ikhwan, is the condition that Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, he mentions for the for a people to be referred to as the Arab. And that he mentions in Kitab al-Iqtida Sirat al-Mustaqim in page 166, or page 166 to 167. That is in the Asl, and not in the two-volume checking of Kitab al-Iqtida. Na'am. And so that is what is intended by the Arab. Number one, that their language is the language of the Arab. Number two, that they are from the children of the Arab. And number three, that they dwell within the Arabian Peninsula, or that they have dwellings or their origins is within the Arabian Peninsula.
أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. أشهد أن محمدا
Now, and so as far then as the Arab themselves, who is it and what is it that we mean by the Arab? First and foremost, ikhwan, it should be known that the Arab with Ahl al-Ilm are of three types. We have the Arab al-Ba'ida, wal-Arab العاربة ممتاز والعرب المستأربة عرب البائدة عرب العاربة and عرب المستأربة. As far as the عرب البائدة, it is a reference, ikhwan, to the extinct Arab. That is the Arab that once existed who are now extinct. Many of the brothers and sisters may not know that there are from among the Arab those who are now considered extinct. Ahl al-Ilm mentioned that the first of the Arab peoples were, or from the first of them, the tribes of Ad and Thamud and their brothers and the neighboring tribes. From the neighboring tribes we have the likes of Tasm and Jadis. That they were tribes, ikhwan, who were brothers, neighboring tribes to Ad and Thamud. Iram likewise. Though from Ahl al-Ilm are also say that Iram and Ad are the same people. And the people of Ad, Allah Azza wa Jal, makes a difference between Ad and Thamud. And that is that Ad preceded Thamud. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in various places in the Quran, وَأَنَّهُ أَهْلَكَ عَادًا الْأُولَى, that Allah Azza wa Jal destroyed عَاد الْأُولَى, يعني the first عَاد. And so they refer to as the first عَاد because ثَمُود is referred to as عَادًا الثَّانِيَة. عَادًا الثَّانِيَة, as Ahlul Ilm mention, as Sadiq Hasan Khan مثلاً mentions, in الدين الخالص and elsewhere. عاد الأولى is a reference to عاد and the people of عاد. عاد الثانية is a reference to ثمود and the people of ثمود. Allah Azza wa Jal destroyed all of them. And it is a possibility that the ربع الخالي, is in the state that it is, just a desolate desert, because of the fact that it was a region that Allah Azza wa Jalla destroyed the people within. As far as the dwelling places though, what was popular concerning where they used to dwell, then what is most popular is that they would dwell in the regions of Hijaz along the peninsula up to Sham, that along the region of Hijaz, which is a reference to Mecca, Medina, Jeddah, Tabuk, then that region, which is on which side of the rectangle? The left-hand side, Ahsan. If you look at the left-hand side from the top of the rectangle, ikhwan, from the top of, from Sham coming along the left-hand side, all of that is referred to as Hijaz, the bulk of that region, yani from the top of the rectangle downwards, is referred to as Hijaz, and it was along that plain, majorly the people of Thamud and Ad, they used to dwell. Though they used to dwell in the whole of the region, they were predominantly in that region. And so they are referred to as the Arab al-Ba'ida, yani the extinct Arab, they no longer exist. Ad, Thamud, Qasam, Jadis, Iram, all of them Allah Azza wa Jal had destroyed them. Some of them mentioned that Tasm and Jadis were destroyed by themselves. That is that they were destroyed by internal fighting among themselves to the extent that they killed themselves and annihilated themselves. And that which remained was the people of Ad, and they were followed by the people of Thamud. Of course, as it relates to the people of Ad, they were the Qawm or the people of Hud. And as far as it relates to the people of Salih, then they were the people of Thamud. And so Allah Azza wa Jal, Ikhwan, destroyed those two nations, and thus, even though they are referred to as being from the Awa'il al-Arab, from the first of the Arab, they are now extinct. The second group, the Arab al-Ariba, they are the original Arab. They are the original Arab. And they are a people who return in terms of their lineage back to Ya'rib ibn Qahtan. Back to Ya'rib ibn Qahtan. And so they were, in terms of the purity of their blood, then the tribes, Ikhwan, the Arabi tribes, those tribes that are considered Arabi, Asil, original Arab tribes, are those tribes whose lineage returns back to Qahtan. And Qahtan, Ikhwan, were Qahtan, Adnan, were from the offsprings of Nuh, alayhi salatu wassalam. From the grandsons, great grandsons of Nuh, alayhi salatu wassalam. So their lineage returns back, in essence, to Nuh, alayhi salatu wassalam. And they are referred to as the Arab al-Ariba, the original Arab. And they used to dwell for the most part in the region of Yemen. They were in the Hijaz, but they were predominant in Yemen. And there were many tribes. As far as the third group, and they are the Arab al-Musta'riba, then the third group of Arab, Ikhwan, were the Arab that were the origin, or the Arab who originated and whose lineage returns back to Ismail. Since Ismail, alayhi salatu wassalam, was not an Arab. Ismail, he was Kanani, and that is that his father, Ibrahim, was from the region of Persia. And they were known as the Khaldun. And they were a Persian people. They were not Arab. His mother was a Qibti, and she was a Coptic from Egypt. And so he then, in essence, Ismail was mixed race. Nah. And Allah Azza wa Jal, of course, Ikhwan, you're familiar with the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal had commanded Ibrahim to bring his wife to the Arabian Peninsula, to Mecca, to be exact, and you're familiar with the story. After Allah Azza wa Jal blessed her with the well of Zamzam, and they were able to dwell within the region, a tribe from the Qahtani tribes, one of the popular Qahtani tribes, the tribe of Jurhum, after the splitting of the dam of Ma'rib in Yemen, which was a dam that was, irrigation within Yemen used to take place, and the people of Yemen, they would exist. After the bursting of that dam, many of the Yemeni tribes were displaced, and so they traveled looking for new places to reside. And of course, Ikhwan, when they would travel, they would look for those regions where they saw birds, because they knew that water was present within them. And so they traveled and saw the valley of Mecca, and they saw within it a woman, and that no doubt was the mother of Ismail, alayhim salatu wassalam. And so they sought permission, which indicates, Ikhwan, the nobility of the tribe. Yani they could have just lived there, but they sought permission to dwell in proximity to her. She gave her permission. She gave them permission, and so they established themselves within the valley of Mecca. When Ismail grew, he married from the tribe of Jurhum, which, as we mentioned, was a Qahtani tribe, and one of the original Arabi tribes. After the marriage of Ismail into the tribe of Jurhum, the offsprings that came, or that issued from that marriage, were referred to as Arab al-Musta'riba. Now, they were not original Arab, but they were. And that is to say, when we are looking at the Arab in terms of their blood lineage, then the original Arab Quh is the Arab that returned back to the Qahtani Adnani tribes. Or the Qahtani tribes. As far as the lineage of the Arab al-Musta'riba, then their lineage returns back to Ismail. And they are Arabi in that Ismail married a woman who was from the original Arab tribes. That which issued from them from offsprings, they were Arab, but Arab Musta'riba. Their origins, Ikhwan, and their lineage returns then back to prophethood, to Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. And so the tribes that were present within the Jazeera were, for the most part, in Mecca, Medina, in those regions, they returned back to Adnan in their lineage, who was from the offsprings of Ismail. And so the difference then between the Arab al-Ariba and the Arab al-Musta'riba is that the Arab al-Ariba, their lineage goes back to Ismail, and the offsprings of Ismail, who married to an original Arabi Qahtani woman. And then if we were to look further back, then those original Arabi tribes go back to Qahtan, who was from the offsprings of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. And so they then, this is who is intended, Ikhwan, by the Arab. We have then the Arab. Firstly, Al-Ba'idah, the extinct Arab. Ad, Thamud, Jadis, Tusum, and Iram, and others. Then we have the Arab, Al-Ariba. The Arab Al-Ariba, the original Arab whose lineage goes back to Qahtan. And then we have the Arab, Al-Musta'riba, whose lineage goes back to Ismail. And so, in terms of the lineage then of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then his lineage goes back to Ismail. And that, of course, Ikhwan, many of you are familiar with the oft-quoted biblical verse that we will send from your brothers, from among your brethren. That verse, Ikhwan, if it is established, then no doubt the Prophet ﷺ was from the brethren of Ishaq and from the brethren of those who were يعني, offsprings of Ishaq, since Ishaq and Ismail were brothers. And so the lineage then of the tribes of Bani Israel and the lineage of the prophets and the messengers, the bulk of them return or were traced back to Ishaq, the brother of Ismail. The tribe of the Arab returned back to Ismail. And so when the Prophet ﷺ was sent, and the people of the book were acquainted with his appearance, and they knew of him coming, when they expected him to be from the lineage of Ishaq, and they realized that he was from the lineage of Ismail, from the Arab, a people who they didn't consider, they rejected him, even though they saw upon him all of the signs, and they knew that everything that their books informed them of, down to his name, Muhammad, which was mentioned, yani the one, the praiseworthy one, and the characteristics as we have them in many ways similar were mentioned within their books, his height, his yani his companions, how they would be, was mentioned in their books. But as Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا كَفَرُوا بِهِ, when they came to them that which, or the one who they knew, they disbelieved in him, they rejected him. Or like the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ, they know him as they know their own sons. And so ikhwan, the affair then within the Arabian Peninsula was one that had within it much of the taqaleed and much of the customs that were inherited from Ismail and from the peoples of Jurhum. But at the same time, we had a lot of customary practices, ikhwan, that were imported. And so within the region, we had individuals, ayyuhal ikhwa, who would practice that which was established in and among and from the prophets and the messengers. And then there were practices, ayyuhal ikhwa, that were ghareeb to the prophets and the way of the prophets and the messengers. So within the region, for example, we had various forms of religion. And likewise, many of the customary practices of the Arab were from those either aspects of religions that were taken, aspects of religion that were taken from Ismail, or from those religions that were imported into the region. From the religions that were imported into the region, and there were various religions that were brought into the region. From those religions though, ikhwan, we had that which is known as Tawtamiyya. And that is something, ikhwan, that is in essence a religion that was present, ikhwan, in the Far East, and it was likewise present among the tribes of the Americas and elsewhere, which is commonly known as totemism. And totemism was a form of religion, ikhwan, that ultimately returned back to paganism, that had in it the belief in the connection between human beings and animals, and the belief in the connection between human beings and aspects of nature. And so in its origin, it was idol worship with other elements that were incorporated into the idol worship. And so, for example, they would believe that there was a connection between the human being and a particular type of animal, or the human being and aspects of creation, mountains and what have you. And so we found that incorporated into their culture. And thus we found many of the early Arab referring to their sons and to their offsprings with names that were and found their origin in animals. Some of those names were used because of the fierceness and the courageousness of those animals. Asad, for example, which is a reference to the lion. Uqab, a reference to a type of eagle. And some of those names would return back, ikhwan, to other elements or other types of animal. Kilab, or Banu Kalb. Elements of creation, like a sakhar, which is a reference to large boulders, or fihr, which is a reference to a large rock that would be used to grind and to pulp, beat elements or foodstuffs to a pulp and what have you. So they will utilize names, take names from elements within the creation, particularly and usually those names that they saw to be names that indicated strength and might. Similarly, Ikhwan, within the region, we had, of course, the worship of the Asnam, the worship of the idols. And idol worship, Ikhwan, was something that was imported into the Jazeera al-Arabiya. It was not something that was present within the region until it was brought into the Jazeera by an individual known as Amr ibn Luhay ibn Amir. Amr ibn Luhay ibn Amir was an individual that was well known among the Arab and that was notable among them, a person of respect and honor among them. And he was a well-known tradesman. And he would travel, Ikhwan, north to Sham. He would travel to Sham for trade. And similarly, he would visit Iraq. And those were regions, since Iraq was a region that was dominated by Persian religion and by the religions of idol worship, there were religions and regions, Ikhwan, that had within them various idols and idol worship. And they saw, he observed, that it appeared that when they would call upon these idols and they would be granted the things that they were asked for. And so he saw that he should bring some of those idols to the Arabian Peninsula. And so this Amr ibn al-Luhay is from the first of those who brought the idols into the Arabian Peninsula. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, as a cousin, an established authentic hadith the Sahih, and Sheikh Nasir likewise discusses it in Silsila, he said, Ra'aytu Amr ibn al-Luhay, ibn Qam'a, ibn Khandaf, yajurru qasabahu fi an-nar. فما رأيت رجلا أشبه برجل منك به ولا بك من. He mentioned addressing one of his companions known as Akhtham ibn Jun al-Khuza'i. He said, Ya Akhtham, indeed I saw Amr ibn Luhay dragging his intestines in the hellfire. Amr ibn Luhay, this one that brought the idols to the Arabian Peninsula. I saw him dragging his intestines in the hellfire. And verily, I have not seen anyone more resemblant to him than you. And no one that resembles you more than him. Yeah, Aktham. And so Aktham, he responded, Asa an yadurrani shabhuhu, ya Rasulallah. He said, maybe my resemblance of him will harm me, O Messenger of Allah. And so the Messenger, he responded by saying, La, innaka mu'min, wa huwa kafir. Innahu kana awwal man ghayra deena Ismail, fanasab al-awthan, wa bahar al-bahira, wa sayyab al-sa'iba, ووصل الوصيلة وحمل حامي. He mentioned that indeed, no, you are a mu'min, you are a believer, while he is a kafir. And he was the first one that changed the deen and the religion of Ismail. And then he mentioned some of the practices that he did. He erected the awthan. And then he mentioned the practices that they would do with the animals, since they would mark the animals in a particular way for the purpose of them being dedicated to the idols or being slaughtered for the idols. So in any case, Ikhwan, he mentions that he was the first then to bring idol worship to the Arabian Peninsula. He mentions, وَهُوَ أَوَّلُ مَنْ حَمَلَ الْعَرَبُ عَلَىٰ عِبَادَةِ الْأَصْنَامِ. He was the first one that caused the Arab to worship the Asnam. As far as the Asnam then, Ikhwan, then the Asnam and the idols that they used to worship, well known, Ikhwan, in the region. Those idols that were worshipped by the people of Nuh were likewise worshipped by the people of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by the tribe of Quraysh. And from those idols, then of course, Ikhwan, they had the idol Hubal, they had the idol Suwa', Ya'uq, Yaghuth, Nasr, Lat, Uzza, Manat. These idols were idols that certain tribes would have and would worship. Some of them were dedicated to certain tribes, while others were related
or worshipped by the Arab in general. In that regard, we have a hadith, Ikhwan Sahih Bukhari, the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, who mentioned سارت الأوثان التي كانت في قوم نوح في العرب بعد أما ود كانت لكلب بدومة دومة الجندل. He mentioned that indeed the Arab or the idols that were present at the time of Nuh عليه الصلاة والسلام, they were transported to the Arab and they would worship them afterwards. He said, as far as what, since Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned, وَقَالُوا لَا تَذَرُنَّ آلِهَتَكُمْ, the statement of the people of Nuh, they said, do not leave alone your idols, yani because of the da'wah of Nuh, لَا تَذَرُنَّ وَدًا وَلَا سُوَاعًا وَلَا يَغُوثَ وَيَعُوقَ وَنَصْرًا وَقَدْ أَضَلُّوا كَثِيرًا. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, they named the idols, Wad, Suwa, Ya'uq, Yaghuth, Nasr, all of those idols were present at the time of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, as far as Wad, then it was the idol that was worshipped by the tribe of Kalb, Bani Kalb, in a region known as Dawmatul Jandal. Dawmatul Jandal, Ikhwan, was in the north between the region of Medina and Sham. Similarly, he mentioned he mentioned وَأَمَّا السُّوَاعُ فَكَانَتْ لِهُذَيْلٍ, that the idol Suwa' was worshipped by the tribe of Hudayl. وَأَمَّا يَغُوثُ فَكَانَتْ لِمُرَادٍ, as far as يَغُوثُ, he was worshipped by the tribe of Murad. ثُمَّ لِبَنِي غَطِيفٍ بِالْجَوْفِ عِنْدَ السَّبَعِ. وَأَمَّا يَعُوقُ فَكَانَتْ لِهَمَلَانٍ, as far as Yaghuth, then it was moved from the tribe of Murad to the tribe of Khatif. And as far as Ya'uq, then it was for the tribe of Hamadan. As far as Nasr, then it was for the tribe of Humayr. They used to worship that idol after the idol was moved and transported to the Jazeera and to the Arabian Peninsula. So the Arab then, Ikhwan, they had those idols transported to them and they would worship those idols within the Arabian Peninsula. And of course around the Kaaba were those well-known idols, Al-Lat, Wal-Walla, Uzza, Wal-Manat, Wal-Qalas, Wa-Dhul-Khalasa, and others. So even though, Ikhwan, we had this idol worship, there were among the peoples of the Arab those who were known for Tawheed. And those who were known to have remained upon the religion of Ismail. Even though much of the ahkam and much of the rulings of that religion had disappeared, they remained upon Tawheed and they disliked Shirk. From them, Ikhwan, we have Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl. Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl was an individual that the Prophet ﷺ himself was affected by. Since he was an individual who was firm upon abandoning the idol worship, and that he disliked worshipping anyone but Allah Azza wa Jal, and that he looked for the religion of Ibrahim, and he would dispraise the Arab on the basis of it. And there are a number of narrations that relate to him. From them, a narration that was mentioned and collected by Al-Imam al-Tabarani in Mu'jam al-Kabir, with the Hassan chain of narration, he mentioned that indeed Amr or Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl kana qad taraka ibadat al-awthan, that he had left alone the worship of the awthan, and indeed he was an elderly man. He was an elderly man, and he was seen resting his back upon the Kaaba. And so he would say to them, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh. He would say to them, O gathering of Quraysh, Walladhi nafsi Zayd ibn Amr biyadi, ma asbaha minkum ahadun ala deeni Ibrahim ghayri. He would say, O gathering of Quraysh, by him in whose hands is Zayd ibn Amr, none of you have remained upon the religion of Ismail other than me. None of you. None of you have remained upon the religion of Ibrahim of what? Other than me.
He mentioned, Allahumma law anni a'lam ayyul wujuh ahabbu ilayk abadtuka bihi. He said, oh Allah, if I knew which way and which direction or which way was more beloved to you, then I would worship you by way of it. So he supplicated to Allah Azza wa Jal and was heard supplicating. وَلَكِنِّي لَا أَعْلَمُ But indeed I do not know. And then he would make sajda upon his riding beast. Now, likewise, it was mentioned concerning him that he did not used to eat the food that was slaughtered upon the altars. Similarly, he would not eat the food that was not or did not have the name of Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned over it. And what he would similarly do is that he would save the young girls, the baby girls, who were due to be slaughtered. Since from the practice of the Arab at that time was that they would slaughter the baby girls. Since they saw the baby girls as a form of weakness for the tribe, men they saw gave the tribe strength. And the ayam of the Arab and the days in which they would praise their forefathers and speak of them, they would speak of that which the forefathers would carry out from bravery, that which occurred among the tribes, the various wars, and those things took place with men. And so they saw then that the girl, they weakened the tribe. And this practice then of killing girls was one that was implemented. Zayd ibn Amr, he would hear of a man intended to kill his daughter, and he would say, give her to me. Don't kill her, give her to me. I will look after her, and I will rear her, and I will nurture her. Then when she is of age, you may either take her back or leave her with me. And he used to despise this practice of them killing the baby girls. And so he was a man, Ikhwan, that was upright, a man that was righteous, even though he did not have the deen in terms of tafasil and detail. Similarly, we have a narration in Sahih Bukhari when the Messenger ﷺ informed that Zayd ibn Amr كان يعيب على قريش ذبائحهم, that he used to dispraise Quraysh for their slaughterings, the slaughtering that they would make for the idols. And he would say, يقول الشات خلقها الله وأنزل لها من السماء ماء وأنبت لها من الأرض ثم تذبحونها على غير اسم الله إنكارا لذلك وعظاما له. He used to say to them, the sheep, Allah Azza wa Jal has created them, and He caused them to drink from the water that He sent down upon them from the sky, and He made them eat from the vegetation that He caused grow. And then you slaughter them for other than Him. And so he would dispraise their practice, Ikhwan, of slaughtering for the idols. Similarly, Ikhwan, in a narration that occurs in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ informed us of the fact that Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl, he went on an occasion to Sham in order to ask and to seek the deen, the correct religion. He said, فَلَقِيَ عَالِمًا مِنَ الْيَهُودِ فَسَأَلَهُ عَنْ دِينِهِمْ. And so he came across an alim from the Yahud, from the Jews, and he asked them concerning their religion. And so they said to him, and he said to them first and foremost, إِنِّي لَعَلِّي أَنْ أَدِينَ دِينَكُمْ فَأَخْبِرْنِي. فقال لا تكون على ديننا حتى تأخذ نسيبك من غضب الله. He said that indeed I am seeking religion, and perhaps I will follow your religion, so inform me of it. And so they said that you will not be able to be of our way and upon our religion until you take your portion of the anger of Allah. Until you take your portion of the anger of Allah. And so he said, مَا أَفِرُّ إِلَّا مِنْ غَضَبِ اللَّهِ. He said, I am not fleeing except from the anger of Allah. And so he said, وَلَا أَحْمِلْ مِنْ غَدَبِ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا أَبَدًا. He said, and I will not have any of the anger of Allah at all, ever. Yani that was what he was fleeing from. He said, and I am not able to withstand that. And so he said, can you then inform me, هَلْ تَدُلَّنِي عَلَى غَيْرِ, can you inform me and point me towards other than this? And so they said, مَا أَعْلَمُهُ إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ حَنِيفًا. So they said, we know of no other religion except that you be Hanif, which is that you remain upon Tawheed. فَقَالَ زَيْدْ وَمَا الْحَنِيفِ قَالَ دِينُ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. Zayd asked them, what is this Hanif? And they responded, it is the deen and the religion of Ibrahim. And so he said, and what was the deen of Ibrahim? And they responded by saying, لَمْ يَكُنْ يَهُودِيًا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًا وَلَا يَعْبُدُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. They said he was not a Jew, neither was he a Christian. Rather, he did not used to worship except Allah. He said, فَخَرَجَ زَيْدٍ فَلَقِيَ عَالِمًا مِنَ النَّصَارَى. And so he continued upon his journey and he came across an alim from the Nasara. Came across an alim from the Christians. He said, when he came across that individual, indeed, I ask you of your deen, and inni la'alli an adina deenakum, that perhaps I may practice your religion, so inform me of it. And so they said, lam takun ala deenina hatta ta'khudha binasibika min la'natillah. He said that you will not be able to be upon our religion until you take your portion of the curse of Allah. And that, ikhwan, continues to be a concept among them, that we are born within sin and within that which causes us to be despised and despicable. And the only way that we can be resolved of that sin is to believe in the blood of Jesus Christ. And so he said, مَا أَفِرُّ إِلَّا مِنْ لَعْنَةِ اللَّهِ. He said, I am not fleeing except from the curse of Allah. So he said, and I'm not able to withstand that, neither his anger. So inform me and point me toward other than this. And so they said, مَا أَعْلَمُهُ إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ حَنِيفًا. They said, we do not know any other way except that you be Hanif. And so again he asked, وَمَا الْحَنِيفِ, and what is Hanif? He said, دين إبراهيم, the religion of Ibrahim. لَمْ يَكُنْ يَهُودِيًا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًا وَلَكِنْ كَانَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا. He was not a Yahudi, neither was he Nasrani, but he was Hanif upon the religion of Tawheed, one who was in submission to Allah Azza wa Jal, not worshipping except Allah. فَلَمَّا رَأَى زَيْدٌ قَوْلَهُمْ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ خَرَجَ مِنْ عِنْدِهِمْ وَقَدْ رَضِيَ بِمَا أَخْبَرَاهُ وَالَّذِي اتَّفَقَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ شَأْنِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. And so when he saw the affair of Ibrahim, he left them and he did not see except that they were united upon praising the affair of Ibrahim. He said, فَلَمَّا بَرَزَ رَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ فَقَالَ اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أَشْهَدُكَ أَنِّي عَلَى دِينِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. And so he left them and said, oh Allah, indeed I bear witness that indeed, or bear your witness that I am upon the religion of Ibrahim. And so Zayd ibn Amr was from among Ikhwan the Arab and those who were present within the region who remained upon the religion and upon the deen of Ibrahim. Similarly from them, and we'll round up with the mention of one or two of them, Ikhwan, from them we had the likes of Amr ibn Abasa As-Sulami, who was a cousin of Hadith Sahih Muslim. كَانَ يَظُنُّ أَنَّ النَّاسَ عَلَى ضَلَالَةٍ, that he used to hold that the people were upon misguidance. وَأَنَّهُمْ لَيْسُوا عَلَىٰ شَيْءٍ وَهُمْ يَعْبُدُونَ الْأَوْثَانِ, and he saw that they were upon nothing while they were worshipping the awthan, while they were worshipping the idols. Likewise from them, an individual known as Quss ibn Sa'idah, he likewise was from among those who did not hold and did not see the worship of the idols. Quss ibn Sa'idah al-Ayadi. We have a narration that mentions, Ikhwan, that he used to yaqif, and he used to stand in the souq, one of the popular markets known as Uqad. And he would stand upon his red camel. He had a red camel that he would ride. And he would say, Ayyuhan nas, Ayyuhan nas, ijtami'u. Oh, people gather. And so when they would gather, he would say, Fasma'u ma aqulu wa'u. He said, he would say to them, listen to what I say to you and understand what I say. And then he would proceed to say, ma asha, man asha, mat. Wa man mata, fat. Wa kullu ma huwa atin, at. He would say that whomsoever lives shall die. And whosoever dies shall be forgotten. That which is coming will come. And he would give them admonition concerning their worship of the idols. Similarly, from them, أيها الإخوة, we had the likes of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, رضي الله عنه. Abu Dharr, أيها الإخوة, was from among those individuals who were not upon the religion of the idol worshippers. Rather, Abu Dharr, he used to make salah before the coming of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would pray. Similarly, that he would face towards the Qibla, and he would pray Isha, and he would pray a late prayer at night. And it is as though Ikhwan Abu Dharr was muwaffaq, that he was inspired, Ikhwan, with the deen of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Na'am. And that similarly, he used to curse the idols and he used to ridicule them. And he would establish the deen that resembles that which the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was upon in the beginnings of his da'wah. And his practice of religion resembling Zayd ibn Amr, remaining upon Tawheed, they would not eat the meat that was slaughtered for the idols, that they would abandon the idol worship, and he would perform salah and pray, make sajda and make dua. And so it is said that Abu Dharr was upon a religion that resembled the deen of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the very beginnings of the prophethood of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so then from them were those who were upon a religion, upon a deen that resembled the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. Of course, they didn't receive and didn't have any ahkam or any rulings, but they attempted to remain upon Tawheed. And then from them, Ayyuhal Ikhwa, were those who had from the ugliest of characteristics and from the worst forms of religion and from the most despicable social practices. And we'll look into that affair, Ikhwan, in next week's session, bi-idhnillah. والله تعالى أعلم وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
You know the two individuals that you mentioned, like the Abu Dharr, were they believers?
They there's a narration that mentioned that Zayd ibn Amr, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, saw him in Jannah, and that he was an ummah between.